Hello and welcome to a brand new show of Market Makers. It's indeed a picture perfect market. Gold prices have come down. We've come on the right side of global events. Earnings have been mixed, but thankfully for us, domestic institutional investors are back and they're back with a vengeance. So is it a good time to invest in markets, or pickup in earnings will be a concern and that will really act as a near-term impediment for markets? So let's connect the dots with one of the smartest fund managers on D Street, Navneet Munot of SBI Mutual Fund AMC. Navneet, fantastic to have you back. Thank you for joining us. You know, for the longest time, I've been tracking markets. As of now, the setting is just perfect. Gold is down, crude is down, China is out, and globally things are in a mess and India will benefit.
Absolutely. I think the credibility of India as a place, as an investing destination, is likely to go up in light of the events that we have seen. The institutional credibility of India after what investors would have seen, what has happened in China and some of the other countries, I think India will stand out within the overall emerging market, we are said. That's my long-term belief. You can't put India along with all the other emerging markets and allocate a small amount of money and within which India gets allocation. I think over the next couple of years, India as a market is likely to get allocation from large investors. I think the size of opportunity which is there, the leadership that we have got, the things that RBI is doing, and the significant opportunity in the market that you get. So most of the other markets where huge amount of growth has happened, they've not been able to deliver that to the equity investors. In India, despite the macro challenges and the political challenges of last 5 years, you could identify stocks that have done
HDFC,
so many of them.
So what's your current view on the market? At 8600 on the Nifty, at 8500 on the Nifty, our market's priced to perfection.
So I don't know about the next few months. Of course, I mean, we have challenges. We have seen in terms of slowdown in the rural area. We are seeing that private capex is likely to take time, the stress in the banking sector, some of the reforms having the desired impact on the economy. But if I take a longer term picture, let's look at two broader things. As I mentioned earlier, the political leadership plus the RBI leadership plus the structural opportunity, and I think India is likely to stand out. The domestic flow of money, I think we have just seen in last 1 year, I think it's a structural long-term trend. And the corporate profitability is absolutely at bottom in terms of the compared with the long-term cycle. So I think we have a long way to go for next several years. And I think every opportunity that market throws, which is induced by something happening somewhere else in the world, what we saw in Greece or China, I think is a good opportunity for investors.
Some would argue
to
that
enter.
We've been just lucky. Indian markets are going up because commodity prices are down. That's nothing to do with India. Yeah. The reason why commodity prices are down is because there is
what's happening in China and the global deflationary
environment. Lucky.
So, I mean, if you put India from a global asset class perspective, I think when you compare with the risk-free rate of return today and look at all the other asset classes, of course, India really stands out. You rightly mentioned about the commodity prices. So when you are in this lower growth, deflationary environment, what it does for India, one, of course, the commodity prices remain low. And from a macro perspective, that's a great story for India. And second, on a relative basis, the attractiveness of India as an investment destination. So we are kind of an oasis of hope in a world which is really growth starved.
Fair point. That's the macro part. Yeah. That's the balance sheet part. That India's macro and India's balance sheet is improved.
Yeah.
But let's look at the P&L, profit and loss account, which is earnings. Earnings are yet to pick up. P's have expanded and the E's have not expanded. And there would be a limit beyond which P multiples will not expand. Have we reached that point?
So I think if you look at the, of course, this quarter results are not going to be great. If you're looking at next 3 or 6 months, of course, you can build that case. But you extend your horizon a slightly more for next couple of years, I think the picture changes dramatically. Mm. Even on the corporate results side, so if you look at bulk of the downgrades have been driven by the global commodities. I mean, companies which are in the global commodities, some companies that have got impacted by the cross-currency currents, some companies that have got impacted by the hit in the rural consumption, and of course the stress in the banking sector. But otherwise, there is a large part of the corporate India which is still doing well. Once you get this cyclical recovery in place, so we have seen the impact of aluminium price or copper price or oil falling in terms of what has happened to those companies' profitability. But the positive side of it, in expanding margins for several companies who are into
provided they can retain pricing. Allocation, retained margins. I looked at.
I think so. Why not? So let's say, I'm just giving an example. Let's say a paint company or several other companies, chemicals companies, which are buying petrochemicals. We have seen the impact in the commodity companies' balance sheet today, P&L today. But in terms of the margin expansion, look at the operating leverage which is there. Your capacity utilization is so low. And when the full impact of all the, not only the input prices, but I think the full impact of the interest cost, the full impact of, I think even the wages is likely to get tapered in terms of growth, in terms of rentals are falling. I think the entire impact on margins plus the top line growth, all we need is, of course, we had the lowest GDP growth in terms of the nominal GDP. Because the inflation has fallen quite a bit. It's just a single digit. But going forward, when you have, you go back to 13-14% nominal GDP growth, I think obviously we are going to see a revival in corporate earnings.
Now, corporate earnings is reviving, but the challenge is that two of the sectors which have been outperforming sectors, which have added to corporate earnings so far for 3-4 years, IT and pharma, they are slowing down. For IT companies, it's not 15%. The new normal is 10 to 12%.
I think so. Yeah, I
so
completely
agree.
So that's
a big drag on the aggregate numbers.
Absolutely.
Sun Pharma has dropped a bombshell. And if Sun Pharma, which is one of the best companies in the pharma sector, if they are suffering because of manufacturing problems, God knows what is in store for the smaller ones. So Indian economy may come back, but the outperforming groups may contract.
So we had this growth in last couple of years, which was driven by a very narrow set of companies, the two sectors that you talked about and few other companies. I think it will become a lot more diverse going forward, number one. Specifically on these two sectors, so I think there is a big transition that's happening in the IT sector. The opportunity, the new opportunities, whether in the infrastructure, whether in the SMAC, the whole social mobility, analytics and cloud, there would be a different set of winners. And you need to identify those winners who will take advantage. Similarly, in pharma, I think in the large cap pharma, I agree with you, probably the expectations are huge. They may not be able to deliver that. But companies that are single product, companies that are looking at new geographies, companies that are going up the value chain in terms of, let's say, specialty pharma, I think there are still lots of opportunities
you not,
there for
you. You not reduced your exposure to pharma?
So I think it's the overweight would be through several of the mid-cap names where there is still, we believe, a lot of opportunities because of the base size that they have at this point in time.
I think the reverse is happening. Large cap companies are still doing okay, but mid cap is where the cleanup has happened. KPIT, if I look at
in IT, this is quite different.
So in IT, large cap is doing better.
Yeah. I was talking about the pharma sector when I said that there could be bigger opportunity for several of the mid cap names where, let's say, a single product can change the fortune of the company. In case of, I think, IT, so far, I think staying with the large cap has done better for you. But I think there is a very big transition that's going to happen in the whole technology.
So who will
field.
Emerge as the winner?
I can't take individual names, but I think the people who are investing today in these new growth opportunities, I think they would be a bigger.
So will the existing players become
forward.
Bigger and better, or this cycle or this transition
in IT?
It would
be both. So overall growth expectations have to be tempered, as you rightly said. I think next few years base case would be 10-12%. Can't really build a scenario of margin expansion. So I think overall the growth expectations have to be tempered. But within that, several of the new fields are likely to emerge. The people who are investing there, I think they could really
is IT cheap a market? And I'm going to keep TCS aside, but barring TCS, the entire sector is available at sub 20 now. I really don't recall when was the last time IT came at such at such cheap valuations.
So, as you rightly said before that, because the sector delivered growth which was higher than the overall profitability growth, and it had a certain premium. As growth becomes more dispersed, any sector that had delivered higher than the market growth will not have that premium. I think that premium is likely to shrink for most of those sectors, for those companies. So, and I think that's a big trend one needs to keep in mind for next several years.
So can we expect the same in pharma? A stock like HUL is trading at 40 times, Nestle 55 times. The terminal growth is not more than 10-12%. There was panic in the world economy. Defensives did well. There is no longer panic in the world economy. Is it time to get logical here?
Some of these large cap staples name, I completely agree with you. Probably the valuations have been rich. Globally, there is huge demand for these kind of income equities. Those who are investing in German bonds or Swiss bonds are looking at these kind of stocks. So globally, their valuations have moved up. Having said that, I think in the overall consumer space, there would be, again, the point that I made for some other sectors, there would be a new set of players. The aspirational consumer in India, as your GDP goes up, and at the the
urban FMCG.
Exactly. So, I think they are going to be.
So you're avoiding rural FMCG, you're buying into urban FMCG.
Not necessarily a rural FMCG or urban FMCG, but I think the more nimble players, the players who are in a niche area today, but as you get this J curve where, you know, your per capita goes from 1500 to 3000 over the next couple of years, if you are investing right.
When you move up the value chain, exactly, when you start buying more products, when you start
eating more
food.
A lot of other things that are happening in the economy today. So let's say a GST, where one of the things that we have been looking at, who are those players who will benefit significantly from the move from the unorganized players to organized players? That would be a big thing. The impact of, you know, the whole logistics, where the benefit will go to some of the consumer companies, because the logistics, the GST, all these things will put some of the smaller players at a significant advantage, which they were not able to capitalize on.
What is the best way to capitalize on GST? Because this is the ultimate trend. This is the ultimate tax move which will change the fortunes of Indian economy. I've been told that 1.5% will get automatically added because of GST.
Yeah. So one way is you look at not only the GST, but you put 5 or 7 things together. GST plus the government's ease of doing business. You look at the changes in the technology. Your ability to build a brand today, what required a 20 years of investment with tens of or hundreds of crores of TV advertisement. Today, through social media, you can reach to a right consumer. Through logistics, you don't have to invest as much as you had to invest. The GST will open up several markets which were not available to you. So all these enablers put together are giving, you know, a certain opportunity to those who are not the incumbent
today. So the
mega
trend is GST. How GST will change the economy?
I think GST is one of the pieces in this whole. So even in ease of doing business, several people who just couldn't expand earlier can expand. I don't have to hire a large team. I can, you know, have my entire IT-related work through a salesforce.com. I think that's a big trend. So overall, your ability to really build a business in a short period of time. And some of these amended, if you have seen, in the consumer space, where a company in a 5-year short period of time could build a couple of 100 crores of sales volume, is a big thing. It's a new trend.
We'll take this conversation forward. What we've discussed right now is what you're avoiding and what is the big trend. I want to get much more specific with you. This is right after the break when we'll talk about industrials, we'll talk about cement, and if Indian economy indeed is on a cusp of recovery, which are the sectors which will benefit. All that and much more right after this break. Welcome back. You're watching Market Makers and we are in conversation with Navneet Munot. Navneet, so far what we've discussed are sectors where there is an issue, whether it's a valuation issue, there is a growth issue. The big trend in front of us is that Indian economy is on a cusp of recovery. The economic activity has not picked up, but core data is looking strong. The government intentions are looking strong. So how should one participate?
So I think if you look at the domestic cyclicals, industrials clearly look good.
Define industrials for me.
Okay, so capital goods, engineering, construction. Look at a couple of things. So let's say the activity in mining is going to start. So people who are in earth moving equipment, people who are into construction, people who are, so all those guys are going to benefit. The activity in the road sector has increased substantially. I expect the same in railways. I expect that in defense. I expect that in power T&D. I expect that in you know, urban transport, several other activities. So both the central and the state governments are going to invest heavily in infrastructure, and which will lead to ultimately a private capex. As the overall capacity utilization goes up across industries, private capex is likely to follow suit. But I think the initial government expenditure and plus this mining activity is likely to push up the activity. Also, there is significant opportunity in terms of the whole manufacturing export in the light engineering side. So when you said they explain me, so let's say you buy forging, abrasives, compressors, gears, bearings, any of these guys, good quality construction players, India will need a lot of construction ability.
But a lot of these stocks have run up already on hope. My only challenge is that I agree with your thesis. But just the way you're thinking, others are also thinking like this.
I think look at their book to bill ratio. Look at the way order books are building. And when the execution improves, just go back to the cycle and see 2003 to 2008, what happened in some of these companies. And I think something similar for next 5 or 7 years. I'm not talking of next 1 or 2 year opportunity. So they may look, you know, richly valued if you take only a 1 year view. But I think over a 5 year view, I think that there's going to be a growth multiplier. The other way to play, of course, cement is a similar theme.
But I looked at ACC numbers, UltraTech numbers. Somehow the numbers are not inspirational. We can say that, okay, Don't look at history, look at the future.
These are early cycle plays. So with some of the names that I took in industrials, as well as the cement are the early cycle plays. Autos is the another one. Commercial vehicles or the even other auto ancillaries, I think they would be the early cycle plays. And longer term, of course, there would be some opportunities in the financials. There would be, similarly, as I mentioned earlier, even in the overall consumer space, we believe the aspirational consumer or the urban, you know, consumer plays could be very interesting.
Is it a good way to bet on the aspiration and interest rate cut by buying
several
autos?
Things. So one of the strong views I have that over the next couple of years in India, we'll have a higher growth with lower inflation, which has never happened to us. We always had a spike in inflation. This time, I think a combination of factors, the fiscal policy, the RBI's determination, and the, I would say, the agreement between the RBI and the government to keep the CPI at 4% will lead to a completely different kind of economy and the impact on the market going forward.
But that could also have impact on wage inflation. Yeah. That could also have impact on the pricing power which FMCG companies have enjoyed. Yeah. FMCG companies have politely increased their prices saying that it's a commodity inflation. Yeah. So pricing power suddenly disappears.
For companies, or you are saying
for
the labor? So for companies, as I said, the full benefit of the cost reduction is yet to reflect in their P&L. That will happen in the next couple of years. And as the overall top line grows, you will see the benefit coming through the bottom line as well with the margin expansion. Margins are at the lowest levels.
So we are at the SBI.
So one of the view that you asked about that consumer thing. So I think the consumer price inflation can structurally remain very low for next several years. We have a global deflationary environment. Commodity prices remaining low, government ensuring all the policies, just like this MSP hike, what we have seen recently, the RBI keeping a tight lid, and over a period of time, if inflation remains low, that's good for discretionary consumption going forward. And interest rates actually staying stable at a low level for an extended period, which we have not seen earlier.
Markets, they love to hate PSU banks, and as we speak, I'm just getting a different vibe at the SBI AMC office. So is it a good time to buy into SBI or, for that matter, PSU banks?
So talking about the office, of course, it reflects the dynamism. It reflects the transformation. It reflects, I think, the aspiration of the parent SBI. And I keep thinking that just like they take, you know, pride in saying banker to every Indian, I hope that I become fund manager to every Indian. So that's the aspiration that we have.
PSU banks.
So we have actually been overweight private sector bank last couple of years. That trade has done very well for us. But one or two banks within the PSU space, I think two or three things that we are looking at. Number one, I think those who have invested in technology big time, those who are going to, I mean, and the who got a great franchise. The other big, I think, swing factor would be the governance reforms, which I'm like quite optimistic in the next couple of years. The challenge as of now is you don't know how much more stress in the asset, which is there, and the impact of the restructuring. You've done the restructuring, but how much is going to hit you more? But at some point in time, I think the valuation gap is something that you shouldn't ignore. At some point in time, if somebody has got the right technology, I think his ability to grow compared to a private sector bank also would be quite decent. And I think that fact should
but
be kept in mind.
But where is the money that PSU banks?
So capitalization, so I think though, definitely, I think government will take care of capitalization to some extent. And also as the overall economy improves, maybe the valuations may improve over a period of time. I'm not saying that you buy them the entire basket, but let's say one or two names definitely are worth looking at.
Let's move from sectors to talk about the mega trends. What are the three or four mega trends for next 5 years?
I think I talked about that India can have a nice period, non-inflationary continued expansion, which will lead to probably an economy having a lot more macro stability, which will lead to a higher savings rate and bigger part of that savings going into the financial markets, financial assets. And this will also lead to probably, several companies benefiting from that overall, the consumer prices remaining lower and then providing an opportunity of entering several businesses. So I think the overall, in almost every single business, we'll see new players really threatening the existing guys.
Disruptive.
One of the big, that's the right word, disruption. And I can see that disruption in several industries, whether it's financial services, whether it's consumer business.
Example.
So in financial services, I think the disintermediation, digitalization is too big a disruptive force. The new set of players would be, the players who would benefit the most are going to be very different than just looking at, you know, all the players. So you can't just extrapolate the growth of, let's say, the credit growth and then the overall banking growth and then make money everywhere. There will be another set of players in financial services. And that thing is going to happen in several sectors. And consumer is a classic thing, which I told you about, some of those factors, how it can give opportunity to a new set of players, and some of the incumbents could be at a disadvantage. When the government is changing the way of doing business and the ease of doing business, I think the traditional way of making money, just example, so let's say if you could get a natural resource at a cheaper price, I think that was a license to make money, that has gone. There would, or let's say a government contract, that license is gone. There would be a new way of
crony
making
capitalism
money.
Is open.
That's completely over for
this
next 7 years.
This is the new
years.
India, what will happen on black
absolutely,
money.
Absolutely.
It could have a short-term impact, but
absolutely.
Long-term, this is great news.
Yeah, yeah. Also, I think the India, I think the whole economic diplomacy of this government, where large number of multinationals who have stayed away from investing or committing big sums to India, I think it could be very different. The FDI, actually, my view is in the next couple of years, FDI numbers could be much higher than the flows that we see in the portfolio side from the PE side. FDI could be very large in India.
So, you know, every market, they follow a cycle. And sometimes markets, they move independently of what is happening in the economy. We've seen that big example, which is China. Do you think this bull market, which is called as the Modi bull market, which started last year, which is 2014 May, is still young, it is still vibrant, and this bull market has a long, long way to go?
I think so. I think, as I mentioned, that it's a nice period, non-inflationary continued expansion for a very long time. We are looking at a very stable micro environment for several years. We are looking at the political leadership, which means business. We are looking at cleanliness, more transparency in governance. We are looking at a corporate sector. There would be new set of players. Maybe the existing people who made money through that crony capitalism, I think there are going to be a different set of players. We have seen something similar in 91. I think if history is any guide, again, we'll see a similar kind of disruption where lots of large established business houses didn't grow as much as the rest of the economy and there were new set of players. Something similar is likely to happen.
You're sounding bullish, but you know, my challenge with a bullish thesis right now is that valuations are not on your side. If the Sensex P was about 10, 11 times and if an economic recovery was staring at us, this was a great market. But maybe markets are factoring in FY17 or even FY18 earnings.
So I think markets could also be factoring a couple of other things. Market is also factoring probably that rates are going to be much lower compared to where we are today. Market is also factoring, I think, the amount of liquidity which is likely to come from the domestic investors. Markets, but the most importantly, in terms of the valuation, market is also factoring probably the expansion in earnings over a five-year period. It's difficult to visualize in the next 6 months or 12 months, but I think what market is factoring in is a sustained growth for the next 4 years.
Now,
and then you get that power of compounding.
Now, what moves stock prices violently and sharply are surprises. If it's a disappointment, stock price will crack. If it's a surprise, the stock goes up. Infosys, good numbers, surprise, stock went up 10%. Sun Pharma, bad commentary, stock cracked by 15%. So what could surprise us? What could disappoint us?
In the very near term, it's different. So maybe that in this parliament session, we don't see some of the bills that market is expecting getting passed. Could be a disappointment. But I think that will be for a brief period. If I've understood well, I think on both these bills that are the most critical, I think broadly there is an agreement. There are more semantics and I think they can be sorted out. And also my belief is that I think the state governments, I think, will play a bigger role going forward. And maybe the other reforms, the overall executive action may continue. That's positive. What can go wrong is, I think, more from the global side and not from the domestic side. But we have seen in last couple of weeks that the resilience that India has shown historically, we have been the highest beta risk asset. We danced historically to the tune of global liquidity, global rates, global sentiments. This time we have shown some difference. And I think that's also due to, one, that global investors are looking at India differently, and also that domestic investors have got a lot more faith in our market. And that's created the difference.
So I will sound repetitive this one. Let's get some closing comments from you. Your view is that it's now and never. Equity is the best asset class given what is happening to gold. What could happen to real estate? Fixed deposits, 8-9%, less than 9% if you're in the top tax bracket. one should stick to equities?
I think if you have a 3, 5, 7, 10 year view, definitely equity is likely to do pretty, I mean, relatively far better than most of the other asset classes in terms of tax efficiency, in terms of, I think, overall return expectations have to go down because there are relatively, as you rightly said, very few opportunities. And overall tax adjusted, looking at the future inflation that I talked about, the consumer, I think equity looks very interesting. Within that, I think your ability to identify the right kind of stocks can actually give can give much better alpha as well.
So 15 to 20% CAGR return for next 3 to 5 years is achievable. It's not a dream number.
Yeah, I think a good stock picker can identify. In last 5 years, despite all those challenges, there are several companies that we discussed earlier have delivered that. I don't see a scenario in next 5 years with better macro, better political leadership. It would be tough.
Wonderful. I hope you get it right. Good luck. Thank you for joining us.
Thank
That's
so
it
much.
On this edition of Market Makers. I'm Nikunj Dalma signing off. Thank you for watching the show.